I have, this kind of goes into the next one that you just kind of said. I've been married 26 years. Hormones obviously slow down for both of us at this point. So what do you suggest to encourage and help couples keep the flame lit? Obviously, you talked about this treats package, you know, that we probably need to be implementing more. Is there anything else that you would suggest on, you know, helping keeping that flame going when you're kind of just used to each other, you know?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. 22 or whatever. Yeah. And now they actually do need a little bit of a warm-up period as well. They need to kind of decompress from work. They need to kind of put some of these stressors off their mind.
I love this right now because I know my husband has been frustrated that he needs like booting up. So this is going to be good to know that, hon, it's normal. Right?
Okay. Yeah. And that's why we're normal. That's why I'm normalizing it. And again, this is information that a lot of people don't have. So they think something's wrong, but they just don't realize that, more, you know, being human comes into play and aging comes into play and you might need to adjust a little to it. Just step on.
Yeah.
And so the two basic concepts to that people need to think about is more emotional connection and foreplay. Okay. And more stimulation, physical, within.
Okay.
Awesome. That's just what you need to add. Yeah. It's not a big deal.
Yeah. Yeah. Great. Yeah. And knowing the benefits of it, it's so worth it.
Yep.
So worth the benefits and the connection it creates. Okay. So this is a funny question. In your research, have you found that being intimate so many times a week provides the relationship with a healthier environment? And if so, what is that number?
Here's the $1 million question, Trina. Yeah. No, I mean, and I'm not a fan of giving a number just because sure is shooting, somebody will use it to kind of beat another person over the head with it.
Yeah.
But having said that, the research tells us that healthy marriages tend to have sex somewhere in the 1 to 3 times a week range. That's kind of on the, I guess I shouldn't say, it's kind of on the high side. That's kind of the healthy couples.
Okay.
Again, obviously there's not 100% of couples are healthy couples. So that's going to be high for maybe a lot of people that we're talking to.
Yeah. Me
personally, as a sex therapist, kind of in the back of my mind, am sort of, unless there's a really good reason not to, I'm sort of shooting for couples to at least have sex once a week.
Okay. Yeah.
And that's my minimum. 1 to 2 would be kind of idealish.
Yeah.
Again, it depends on age, depends on any other physical, psychological issues in the marriage, but we start to run into more problems when there's too much space between. And it signals other issues in my book, which is I'm all about the wholeness and completeness and oneness concept. And so it kind of leaves a little bit of that out, especially when we know that most men feel love through affection and through touch of some kind. Mm-hmm. So I just know that the marriage is probably not in its strongest state.
Yeah.
I'm looking at less than that.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes sense to me. Cause I know in times that we've gone through dry spells, all of a sudden, any issues bigger, all the problems are as big as mountains, you know, and then we'll all find time to have that intimate moment. And then all of a sudden it's like, well, why was I stressed about that? Why was I worried about that? You know, like I said, it's a healer. It really is. I do believe that.
Well, and Trina, just to kind of support that point, remember there's a whole bunch of dopamine and oxytocin, especially, that you're missing out on. Again, this isn't your reason to go have sex by itself. But I just want to remind people of when you've got a fair bit of that oxytocin flowing on a fairly regular basis from touch, eye contact, affection, sex, any of these things, then that's why the frequency is sort of important in the bigger picture.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so true. That was great. Perfect. All right. This is a funny one too. If you could pick one thing that women could do or think about to help them get in the mood, what would it be?
Okay, that's a good one. Yeah, I think the main thing to think about for women is that because we're not thinking about it very often, so men, my kind of analogy is that, you know, men have this window that opens 15 times a day, sex window that opens 15 times a day. And during sex, we're trying to focus on that window and close all the other 15 windows.
Yeah.
So one of the gist, the basic gist is any way, anything that we can do that can help us to kind of have it on the forefront a little, that can make a difference. So a lot of my clients, the, one of the first things I kind of prescribe is any of my audiobooks, my podcasts, or other good books that are on audio, because it plays then in kind of the background of your life. Mm-hmm. And you start to have it kind of be a little bit more of a normalizing influence. So that's one. A second one is even just music. Some people, you know, they're like, oh, I never listen to the radio, or I never listen to, you know, popular music. I just listen to, you know, church music, or I just listen, and I'm just like, well, that's great, except if you're trying to develop your spiritual, your sexual relationship, you might want to tweak that a little.
Yeah.
Because music is a really easy way to get in the mood.
Big influencer.
Big
influence.
A third one is texting playful texts to your spouse during the day. Mm-hmm. Being connecting, being that teasing and playfulness. That teasing and playfulness is probably my number one. If I have to choose one thing to look at how a marriage is doing, I'm going to look at how playful they are. Mm-hmm. Because that really kind of encompasses so much of everything. And I'm talking from a non-naturally playful person. Yeah. I'm very type A. And so, like, I can be spontaneous if I schedule it.
Yeah.
And so this is a learned behavior for me. Yeah. I have to learn this. But so some of these things can help just keep it a little bit more on the forefront.
Okay. I love that. I love that. Well, and that kind of takes us over into, and we kind of talked about this at the beginning. This question was on how much energy should a woman spend on making sure intimacy gets given enough attention in her marriage. You mentioned in the book to use details like sheets and nighties, smells, candles. Should this be something women should spend more time thinking and planning? Because isn't that part of the emotional part for us? If we're actually like putting the night together and planning it, that's part of foreplay for me.
Yeah, that is our foreplay.
You know,
our foreplay begins, Trina, the minute the previous lovemaking ends.
Okay. All right. I like that.
All the context. That's emotional context. That's physical context. That's everything that occurs between then and now.
Oh my gosh.
It's all foreplay.
I love that. I have these candles that sit over the top of my bed. And I remember a friend of mine came in the house and was just looking, and she saw my candles. She goes, those have been lit? I'm like, yes, they've been lit. And she was like shocked. I thought it was something. I'm like, of course I've lit them.
That's just sad.
I know. Sad. It really is. It really is, because there's like a whole nother part of intimacy that I think a lot of women have not been able to embrace and experience.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's the reason we are talking about it.
Yes, it is. Yeah. Well, and a couple of thoughts about that, Trina. So number one, a lot of times women need these things for our sexual fulfillment. We need that context. We need to wear the lingerie. We need the candles, the dimly lit and the music. We need that. So a lot of that can just be because it's functional. It helps us.
Yeah.
A lot of it can also be, you know, and now if I just kind of go, you know, back to not just those specific treats, well, and let me just continue on with, this is also what makes long-term marriages able to really go the distance with pizzazz, with, to create a sextraordinary marriage, is that we're constantly doing something that's a little new, a little different, because the brain really does like novelty. And so if we can let it have a little bit of that, again, that can go too far, which is where addiction takes you. Now you're addicted to novelty, almost, that same reward system in the brain. And so, it's really important for long-term purposes as well. But kind of if women don't make sex a priority, you do run into some dangers. We've got divorce on the table. We've got just dissatisfaction with sex, with marriage. You've got an unhappy husband, you've got an unfulfilled, unconnected, you know, if you've got an unhappy husband, you probably have an unhappy wife, because nobody wants to meet each other's needs if nobody's needs are getting met. So again, I just need one of them to make the change, and we can change it. And then we're also more vulnerable to outside influences. So, you know, if we can make this an important part of a great marriage, you just, you protect yourself. You're just less vulnerable to all of the crap out there.
So true. It's so, true.
It's kind of a big deal.
Yeah, it is a bit, it is a big deal. And that actually follows us right into the next question, that sex as is such an important part of our marriage that I, like I said, I call it foundational. And if it's not good, it does affect everything. I love the quote you had in there from President Kimball. Oh my gosh, I'd never heard it. And that, that sex incapability is the root cause of divorce.
Yeah.
And like he said, it might not be what's talked about in the actual divorce, you know, in the divorce in the courtroom, but that that is a root cause. So that kind of tells you how important it is. It's so important. And so, and you've already kind of clarified this question that, that because of that, that is the reason why it is important that women take the time to embrace their sexuality.
Yeah.
And it's up to us how it's going to do it.
Yeah. I think that quote is so good. I just pulled it up. It's actually in the introduction of that book as well. And so I just thought I would read it because it's so great. But it's like, he says here, divorces often occur over sex. If you study the divorces, as we have had to do in these past years, and this is old, this is an old quote too.
Yeah.
You will find that there are many reasons. Generally, sex is the first. They did not get along sexually. They may not say that in the court. They may not even tell that to their attorneys, but that is the reason. And we do know that sex is up there in, you know, it may not be number one right now, but it's definitely right up there at the top. It's, you know, money, finances, you know, in-laws, household responsibilities, those are all up there, but sex is definitely with. And sex is probably higher up there than with the proliferation of pornography as well.
Yeah. So. I imagine for sure. Okay, so now I want to move over into teaching children about sex.
Yeah.
Your part in there is fantastic. I absolutely loved it. I wish, like I said, I would have known. I did not have anybody teach me. So I never had that experience. So when it came time to teaching my kids, I was like a deer in the headlights. What do I do? How do I say, you know? And luckily my husband, he's really good at it. He taught the first three. He did it all on the first three.
Wow.
And so I was really grateful. I was really grateful for him. But I love how you talk about if we would be more open, if we would share more openly with our children at a young age, that it takes away their curiosity about sex and wanting to discover things on their own. Can you discuss a little bit more about this?
Yeah, I think, you know, you've kind of already mentioned it, but, you know, the key is just this, we're trying to change the taboo energy surrounding sex to change it to a very comfortable, accessible, confident, casual conversation where, you know, in today's society, if you're kind of not having a fairly open, ongoing conversation with your kids, I guarantee they're learning it somewhere else. And you're not going to be happy about what they're learning. Because, I mean, this ongoing conversation that we need to be having is you're needing to unteach a bunch of things they're learning everywhere else. Mm-hmm. And if you don't stay kind of caught up with that, you know, you're going to get way behind. And so that it is really an important thing to be doing. And I think that ideally... And I don't want to give people a reason to not talk to their kids, but ideally, if we can get couples to get their crap together, then they are going to naturally be able to teach and provide a feel about sex that's just so much easier and healthier and right that it'll be a lot easier to do. But I don't want people to not do it if they haven't got it all figured out themselves. But we are looking for that comfortable, and that's why, you know, the last three chapters of the book of And They Were Not Ashamed, I walk people through how to even practice in the mirror some of these conversations so that you fake it as well as possible.
Yes,
no big deal.
I love the realness of that, because it is true. I mean, you're talking to your 12-year-old son and you're like, you know, sometimes we do. We almost need to practice it. Like, okay, yep. I can say these words, you know. Yep. And I do believe that as we do it and as we work on it, it's going to get easier. It's going to get better. And we're going to see the benefits. We're going to see the benefits of them learning from us. Because I know when my kids were all young, we learned, my husband and I, when we were young married, that their first impression of sex is going to be their lasting impression. Yeah. And so if we can set that first impression, how much more powerful that is than if somebody else does it.
Yeah, and you also bring up a good point, just even in our response to anything sexual. This includes how you change a child's diaper. This includes how you respond if you happen to catch them looking at themselves, trying to figure themselves out at young ages, how you respond if you catch a teenager looking at porn. Yeah, all of those things contribute to their sexual conditioning and their sex education. And so that's why if parents have done all of this work that you're having these women do, then all of the responses are just a little bit different now because of that work that they've done. Yeah. So yeah, that's a part of their condition of that process as well.
Yeah. I love that. Okay. So my next question is, I have a son who just got engaged. Yay. So we are super, super excited. And I so want to give them this book and have them read it. But as we had our, one of our webinars that we do online, several of the moms are like, but what do you do? How do you keep them safe? Because it's really going to arouse some feelings and stuff. And so do you have any advice on that to moms as we want to share this with these engaged couples?
I don't know that it's so much advice, but just things to think through is that every child is so different, of course. And so, and where things are at with them and what's going on is such, so only a parent can make a really good advice right here based on that child. But here are some concepts that I would think with. Number one, I really don't like the idea anymore of couples going into marriage or into a honeymoon without a fairly decent dose of this information. I'm working with couples 15, 17, 20 years into marriage that we messed it up so bad that first night that we are still undoing the damage. So that's my first context. Mm-hmm. So secondly then, okay, so there's a lot of different ways we can do it. Women, I think, are a different story because again, we're four steps away from desire. Mm-hmm. So, and our arousal is just a slower build. So I think that the girls can pretty much read this almost anytime, unless they personally know that they struggle with feelings like this. Because women are becoming a little bit more likely to move into compulsivity, sexual compulsivity, porn addiction, that is becoming a little bit more normal, or more not normal, frequent. Yeah. Unless that's in the mix, I almost am fine with any girl reading any of this stuff, even after the age of 18. I mean, I have a daughter on a mission for our church right now. And I mean, I would have let her read my first book before she left, but I was like, honey, there's not really a point. You're leaving in a couple months, but yeah, if you want to read it when you get back, if you want to read them both when you get back, no big deal. Yeah. So it's different for girls than it is for guys. Okay. Now for your son, I think that still there's probably a way that I would try to figure out how to make that work for my son. That might be he only reads it out in the living room. He doesn't read it with her. He reads it on his own, and then maybe they talk about it if they're at a public place. I would just brainstorm and think outside the box a little bit and talk to him and have him try it and see what it was like. And if that conversation is pretty open and casual, you're going to be able to kind of go, I might need to wait. Okay, then you better wait to read it. Okay, then let me tell you a few things you better know before you go.
Yeah.
And having your mother tell you is less going to be less arousing.
Oh, that's terrible. So true. Hey, well, that's our
we just answer. Found an answer.
It is. Moms, you just need to teach your sons.
They're going to die. Your
totally.
Do you get that, Trina? Do you get that?
Yeah. So, and do you have an opinion on, like, that before they're getting ready to go get married. Because I've always told my husband, I'm like, I really want you to talk openly. You know, I had to have a discussion with Thailand and making sure that, you know, he knew everything he needed to know going into it. Mm-hmm. I don't know how much he really did do because I wasn't there. Do you suggest it always be the same gender that's doing that, or can the mom do it for the son? What is
That's similar to how I talk about how to even do that first, you know, some of those other conversations. You know, sometimes it works better when a child doesn't feel ganged up on with there's two parents. Wow. Sometimes it works better when the same gender parent does it. Sometimes it works better when just any parent will do it, and whoever will do it, that's the one we have do it.
Yeah.
Because there's usually one spouse that's a little more me. And then one that's a little more normal and mellow and doesn't want to talk about that stuff as much. So whoever's willing, it's fine. Ideally, I don't have any kids married yet, but they're all older. I would imagine all of my kids could have a conversation with both my husband and I there. But I can still imagine individually talking with them, because it's just different to have a one-on-one conversation than have a two-on-one conversation.
Yeah.
And at the very minimum, I'm still a little nervous because I don't think the information is widespread enough for even parents to know, that I still would almost want these kids to read chapter 3, 4, and 5 of my first book and or my second book. Because I don't think a parent is going to tell them enough. Like, oh, by the way, a girl is 4 steps away from desire. She has to decide, and she has to be talked into it. That's emotionally connected with, and then touched into it, a little bit of arousal, and then she has desire. So, that, you know, I can't imagine very many dads knowing that much and thinking it that well. Mm-hmm. And if they don't have that, I really would rather they read a book.
Yeah, that's true. I like that. And I also am going to suggest that they take the book with them on their honeymoon.
Absolutely.
And that should be like a big study resource.
Required, yep.
I totally think, how valuable that would be. Yeah. How valuable.
And that will be exactly the same with, you know, my knowing her intimately and then knowing him sexually. Okay. That could easily be a study time of a honeymoon if people really wanted to.
Yeah.
Because it's just information people don't have enough of.
Yeah. No, I love that. I'm so grateful that you have chosen to have this be your path in life. You are helping so many people. And I pray that it just keeps snowballing and we just get the word out and that women start feeling comfortable talking about it. And especially women that have struggles, that there's a resource somewhere that they can communicate with and learn from that's safe and not extremely worldly, because obviously we're so gun shy about anything like that. And so this is a really safe place. So I'm super.
Trina, that's exactly what we're going to do. That's what I'm going to do. No matter. I mean, that's, you know, unless the Lord comes down himself and says, yeah, stop doing that. This is what I think I'm called to do. And that's what I think I'm going to do. And I have no interest in stopping, no matter who gets in the way. So
we've
got to get it done.
I love it. Okay, so my last question. I have been so anxious to ask you this question. One of my clients, she actually saw you in Boise. They lived in Boise, her and her husband, and they loved you, and then they moved. But she said, I just said, so what did you think of her? How did you guys connect with her? And she goes, you know, the one thing my husband and I both agreed upon is how feminine she is. And this is something this is part of what I work with women, because the world has masculated us. We are so masculine. We take on way too much accountability, which that's a masculine trait. We don't have the testosterone to handle how much accountability we do take on. And then also just, we're not connected to our feminine side. And we let go of, it's like, I teach women that after they get married, they become intense. This intense woman comes into play. We forget the contentness and the playfulness and the spontaneity. Even connected to spiritual, there's all these areas that we kind of give because we're now taking over the relationship and trying to make sure he's civilized and saved. And I have this whole concept that I teach them. And so one of the things we do every month is I have a feminine challenge, something that they have to do weekly to help them embrace their femininity. So how you working in a masculine world, because, you know, you're obviously working with clients, you're hearing all of them, their issues, and then you have to go home and somewhere you have to transition. What do you do? Because I can even feel it talking with you that you have embraced your femininity. How do you do that? Is it because you talk about sex all day?
Well, you're close. I think a big part of it is, number one, all of the self-development work I've had to do is it naturally brings you to more of this wholeness place. And part of, and then the second part of it is to actually embrace your sexuality, you're embracing your femininity.
Oh,
you are. And that's why I can see God's hand in why sexuality is so important and why it feels sometimes like the crowning jewel of a marriage. Yeah. I mean, it's the one thing you can, you know, according to, you know, Christian thinking, it's the one thing you can have in marriage that you can't really have anywhere else.
Yeah.
And, you know, that sexual relationship is so profound. And I totally chuckle to hear this question, because I literally am a very masculine personality, really annoying and obnoxious to my poor husband, but I'm actually very, I've got all of those driven, independent, aggressive. I'm naturally that, just with personality. Mm-hmm. So that makes it almost a little tougher, mm-hmm. where I'm not the normal feminine characteristics naturally. Yeah. So all of those have been developed for me. And that's why I said number one was just the self-development work that you do. You kind of come into your own. You come into, you know, if you're doing good therapeutic self-development work, you're becoming your more your divine self,
yeah.
what you yeah. were always supposed to be.
Yeah.
And I think sexuality just seals the deal on you developing your femininity. I also think that there are, you know, a couple kind of specific things. Letting your husband, not letting, but honoring and respecting your husband as he is also a way you practice your femininity. Mm-hmm. Because if we, I mean, again, I'm the worst offender because I already am so driven, proactive, you know, type A, red personality anyway, that I have to really be attentive to that in order to keep that balance between, everybody has masculine and feminine traits. My job was just a little bit tougher to develop the feminine ones and to take the masculine ones down a bit. But again, it's doable, and it's just symbolic or symptomatic for me of what wholeness looks like.
I love that. And you validate the fact that it's a conscious effort. We have to consciously choose, okay, I'm going to work on this. I'm going to do better at this. That if we don't ever choose to do that, it's not going to just happen naturally on its own. We yeah. have to consciously be working towards, you know, self-improvement, the self-help, pushing ourselves.
Yep.
And I love that. I love that.
That's what marriage is all about. Yeah. Marriage is all about self-development. I think God's primary purpose for marriage, why it's the crowning jewel of, I think, his plan for us, is in marriage, you can't get away with not fixing the areas you need to fix, or your marriage won't survive or thrive.
Yeah.
And then whatever marriage doesn't cover, parenting comes along.
Yes. Yes. Yeah, so true. If there's any missing areas, it's going to be found. Eventually yeah. found. They will point it out very directly.
Very directly.
Yes, for sure. So we will end on this one last question. Is there any one thing you wished all women knew and understood?
I think the number one thing I want to say is you can do this. Women can do this. I mean, I've done this. I know that this is what God would have women get and understand and embrace and bask in. And so related to that is embrace your sexuality, nurture your sexuality, develop this part of yourself, not just not just for your husband. I talk about in chapter one of my second book, these three levels of sexuality. Level one is I do sex and I don't want to, but I do it for my husband and I'm kind of angry about it. Mm-hmm. Level two is I've got a better attitude. I still am mostly doing it for my husband, but it's at least pleasant and sort of enjoyable. Level three is what I'm shooting for, which is I've embraced it. It's part of my wholeness. It's part of what makes me complete and alive, and I am doing it for me and for him, and that makes it all the more awesome. And that's how we can move towards what I believe we all are capable of, which is a sextraordinary marriage. It's an awesome marriage with that extra wonderful piece of the sex part too.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. Thank you so much for your time.
It was fun.
I really admire the work that you're doing, and I just want to yell at the top of my lungs to everyone, you got to read this book. I might have to like do a church talk and stand up and and really shock everybody.
Yeah, I'm so grateful that you're doing this. I'm so grateful to anyone out there that is trying to do something in this category, because it's such a tough area. And I think that's why I love this so much, is that I know that it's difficult. So there's my masculine positive coming in, is that I'm kind of excited by the challenge instead of scared by it. Yeah. And so I think God knew that and he used that to his advantage, and
sure,
we're going to get this done.
Awesome. So, so great. Well, thank you so much. We look forward to, we're going to eventually later on this year, read this one as our book club. I will read it before then. But I'm super excited, and I wish you the very best.
Thanks so much, Trina, and good luck to all your ladies. I'm cheering them on.
All right. Thank you so much.
You betcha.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.